morning. In order to start the morning off, I thought I'd start you with a brief history lesson of how we came to this day. In 1918, on the 11th hour of the 11th day in the 11th month, the world rejoiced and celebrated. After 4 years of bitter war, an armistice was signed. The war to end all wars was over. November 11th, 1919, was set aside as Armistice Day in the United States to remember the sacrifices that men and women made during World War I in order to ensure a lasting peace. On Armistice Day, soldiers who survived the war marched in a parade through their hometowns. Politicians and veteran officers gave speeches and held ceremonies of thanks for the peace they had won. Congress voted Armistice Day a federal holiday in 1938, 20 years after World War I ended and just as World War II was beginning. In 1953, townspeople in a small town called Emporia, Kansas, called the holiday Veterans Day in gratitude to the veterans in their town. Soon after, Congress passed a bill introduced by a Kansas congressman renaming the federal holiday to Veterans Day. So what is this day? It is a day for all Americans to remember those who sacrificed for our behalf, an opportunity to pray for peace, and a chance to give thanks to current and former members of our military services. Today is my honor to welcome you to Fairview High School. Our JROTC has put together a tremendous program that we hope you will enjoy. At this time, I will turn the microphone and program over to our cadet corps.
Carry on. Will you please stand for the presentation of colors and the national anthem played by Fairview, Sound of Gold, and sung by Mr. Allen. Thank you.
If you may, would you please bow your heads in prayer? Lord, we come to you on bended knee, heads bowed and our hearts filled to overflowing with so much grief for the many people who have been injured and killed in our national crisis. We ask you, O Lord, to give courage and strength to those who so bravely go to their aid. And though their hearts will be heavily and filled with sorrow, we ask you, O Lord, that you give them the endurance needed to help them through this difficult task. Please give us the strength, O Lord, to get through each difficult and devastating day that faces each of us and our country. Protect and guide our military that are now being called to duty. We ask you, O Lord, that you guide the leaders of our great country in their hour of decision. The burden has been placed on their shoulders during this crisis, and it is overwhelming. We ask you, with your infinite wisdom, you guide them gently to the right decisions. And lastly, O Lord, we ask you to allow us to come together as a nation, to stand tall and united, so we might help each other in our hour of need. God bless our vets. Without them, there would be no America. Amen.
Would everybody be seated, please? Could you stand and join me in saying the Pledge of Allegiance? I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Would you be seated again, please? This morning, as I was standing in my classroom saying the Pledge of Allegiance with my students, I thought back to about 50 years ago when I was a small boy in elementary school. And I thought of what my teacher, Mr. Laswell, said to us, the class, about the Pledge of Allegiance. And here's what he said. He said, I've been listening to you, ladies and gentlemen, pledge the Pledge of Allegiance all semester. And it seems as though it is becoming monotonous to you. If I may I recite it and try to explain to you the meaning of each word. I, that's me, an individual, a committee of one. Pledge, this is dedicate all of my worldly goods to give without self-pity. Allegiance, my love and my devotion. To the flag, our standard, Old Glory, a symbol of freedom. Whenever she waves, there's respect because your loyalty has given her a dignity that shouts freedom is everybody's job. United, that means we all have come together. States, these are individual communities that have united into 50 states, 50 individual communities with pride and dignity and purpose, all divided with imaginary boundaries, yet united to a common purpose, and that's love for country. And to the Republic, a state in which sovereign power is invested in representatives chosen by the people to govern. And government is the people, and it's from the people to the leaders, not from the leaders to the people. For which it stands, one nation. One nation meaning so blessed by God, indivisible, incapable of being divided, with liberty, which is freedom, the right of power to live one's life without threats, without fear, without some sort of retaliation, and justice. This is the principle or quality of dealing fairly with others, for all, which means, ladies and gentlemen, it's as much your country as it is mine. Thank you very much.
Gotta find it first. The flag folding ceremony represents the same religious principles on which our great country was originally founded. The portion of the flag denoted on honor is the canton of the blue containing the stars representing the states our veterans served in uniform. The canton field of the blue dress from left to right and is inverted only when draped as a pail on the casket of a veteran who has served his country honorably in uniform. In the Armed Forces of the United States of America, as the ceremony of retreat, the flag is lowered, folded in a triangle, and kept under watch throughout the night as a tribute to our nation's honored dead. The next morning, it is brought out, and at the ceremony of Reveille, run aloft, and is a symbol of our belief in the resurrection of the body. The first fold of our flag is a symbol of life. The second fold is a symbol of our belief in eternal life. The third fold is made in honor and remembrance of the veterans departing our ranks and who gave a portion of life for the defense of our country to obtain peace throughout the world. The fourth fold represents our weaker nature, for as American citizens, trusting in God, it is in Him who we turn to in times of peace, as well as in times of war, for His divine guidance. The fifth fold is a tribute to our country, for it, in words of Stephen Decatur, our country, in dealing with other countries, may she always be right, but it is still our country, right or wrong. The sixth fold is for where our heart lies. It is with our heart that we pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. The seventh fold is a tribute to our armed forces, for it is through the armed forces that we protect our country and our flag against all enemies, whether they be found within or without our boundaries of our republic. The eighth fold is a tribute to the one who entered into the valley of the shadow of death, that we might see the light of day, and to honor our mother, for whom it lies on Mother's Day. The ninth fold is a tribute to womanhood, for it has been through their love, faith, loyalty, and devotion that the character of the men and women who have made this country great have been molded. The tenth fold is a tribute to the Father, for He too has given His sons and daughters for the defense of our country since he or she was first born. The 11th fold, in the eyes of the Hebrew citizens, represents the lower portion of the seal of King David and King Solomon and glorifies in their eyes the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. The 12th fold, in the eyes of the Christian citizen, represents the emblem of eternity and glorifies in their eyes the God of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost. When the flag is folded completely, the stars are utmost remaining of our nation's motto, "In God We Trust." After the flag is completely folded and tucked in, it takes on an appearance of a cocked hat, ever reminding us of the soldiers who served under General George Washington and the sailors and Marines who served under Captain John Paul Jones, who followed by their comrades and shipmates in the armed forces of the United States of America, preserving the rights, privileges, and the freedoms that we enjoy today.
It is the soldier, not the reporter, who has given us freedom of press. It is the soldier, not the poet, who has given us the freedom of speech. It is the soldier, not the campus organizer, who has given us the freedom to demonstrate. It is the soldier who salutes the flag, who serves beneath the flag, and whose coffin is draped by the flag, who allows the protester to burn the flag. My name is Cadet Major Paige Butler. The Cadet Corps wants to recognize the faculty, staff member of Williamson County Schools, and family members of Fairview High School that are serving or have served in the U.S. military. the staff members, David Fultz, who was a major in the U.S. Army from 1975 to 1995. Please stand, your name is called. Bob King, who was a captain in the United States Army from July 65 to August 76. Robert Meacham, who is a sergeant in the Tennessee National Guard, who is now serving. Ray Smith, who was a sergeant in the United States Air Force from 1969 to 1973. Daniel Lampley, who was a sergeant in the United States Army from 1968 to 1970. And Larry Hill, First Sergeant in the United States Army from 1968 to 1992. And for the Williamson County members, James D. Griffith was a Chief Master Sergeant in the United States Air Force. Mark B. Samuels was a captain in the United States Navy. Philip Devine Jr. was a Command Master Chief in the Navy. And for the family members, Jeremy Seaton, who is now serving in Iraq in the United States Army, who is the nephew of Peggy Elliott. Ensign Joshua Haggard, who is at pilot school for the United States Navy, who is the son of Saren Cornwell. Frank A. Caperso, Jr., who is a sergeant in the United States Air Force, and he's the husband of Gabrielle Caperso, Jr. Todd Reed, who is a major in the Special Forces in Middle East in the United States Army, and he is the nephew of Debbie Combs. And Jared Bailey, who is a First Lieutenant in the United States Army, 101st Airborne, and he is a member of Bob King's family. And at this time, I'd like to ask if there was any names that I didn't call to please stand. Thank you.
I'll be reading a poem called Our Wounded. They have given dearly for our country's sake, thankfully escaping the fallen's wake. Many returning to duty and doing the same, while others come home and fighting the pain. Oh, so many have spilt their blood, leaving a hand, arm, leg, or more in the red blood. Seldom pointing the finger of blame, keeping their heads high with no shame. They go forward with their lives, even if memories cut like many knives. Comforted by the support of family and friends, who are there with no precedence. So I remember these unsung ones too, who are wounded doing their part too, and earn the Purple Heart, as surely they deserve our pride and gratitude. All right. Veterans, when your service is called, stand forth and be honored. United States Army. Right. United States Navy. United States Marine Corps. United States Air Force. And United States Coast Guard. Ladies and gentlemen, these are your veterans. Give them a round of applause.
Our guest speaker today is someone who many of you already know. His name is Sergeant Robert Meacham. He received his undergraduate degree at Campbellsville University. He enlisted in the United States Army in the year 2002, where he served 4 years on active duty with the 3rd U.S. Infantry Regiment, commonly known as the Old Guard, stationed in Washington, D.C. The Old Guard performs military honors funerals at Arlington National Cemetery. In 2006, Sergeant Meacham came to Fairview High School. He is currently assigned to Bravo Troop, 1st Squadron, and the 278th Armored Cavalry Regiment based at Springfield, Tennessee. He just won the 1st Squadron 278th ACR Non-Commissioned Officer of the Year competition. He will be competing for the NCO of the Year for the 278th Armored Cavalry Regiment at Knoxville during the month of December. His awards include the Expert Infantry Badge, the Parachutist Badge, the Army Commendation Medal with one oak leaf, ARCM, and the Army Achievement Medal. Please give a warm welcome to Sergeant Robert Meacham.
Not sure I deserve that. In the Old Guard up in D.C., I stood out on a parade field for many a general as they retired. And for about 3 hours in the sun one hot August, I was wondering what could this guy possibly be saying that deserves me standing out here in my blues for 3 hours. So when I get over 3 hours, I told my wife to give me a heads up and tell me that it was time to be done. All right? At least you get out of class, right? In all seriousness, it is a huge, huge honor for me to stand here today, not only to speak on the topic of Veterans Day, but also it's a huge honor, it's even a greater honor to be here standing in front of the presence of so many distinguished veterans. Myself, I did a tour overseas in the Horn of Africa. But I don't consider myself a veteran. You know, my dad was a veteran, two tours in Vietnam. Both my grandfathers are veterans, both served in World War II. My great-grandfather in World War I. I'm from 5 generations of Army soldiers, but I don't consider myself a veteran because I still have a lot left to serve. And I will continue to do it so that this generation sitting in front of you kids, so that they can rest assured in their freedoms. As I was preparing and I was writing some stuff down, I looked at my wife and I said, you know, what's gonna happen is I'm gonna write all this good stuff down and then I'm just gonna walk away from the lectern and just talk. It really does me no good because I want to talk to you from my heart and where I'm coming from and what being a veteran, what being part of the armed forces really means. And Mr. Smith kind of stole my thunder a little bit because I was going to talk about the Pledge of Allegiance and what it meant. And he summed it up very well. But you know, there's something about it that really kind of gets under my skin. And you know what? I've got the microphone, so I'm going to talk to you. What gets under my skin is being in a classroom at this high school and saying the Pledge of Allegiance and having kids stay seated. That gets under my skin. Not only does it show a lack of pride, it shows a lack of respect. Because that flag that hangs there, and this beautiful flag here, and the flags that you see all over, and the flags that hang in every single one of your classrooms, was bought and paid for by the blood of veterans. And that, in itself, whether you say the words or not, I don't care whether you stand up and cover your heart and pledge allegiance. I want you to stand. Show respect. That's what I want. I want you to respect not me. I want you to respect these gentlemen. And the gentlemen and ladies that have fought and bled and died for the Stars and Stripes. That's incredible. Lay down. Definitely doesn't belong on the floor. I have a couple questions. In your life, you're going to come across a lot of trials, a lot of hard times that you're going to be forced to fight for. And eventually, you have to look at it and you have to say, is this worth fighting for? And there are a couple of things that I know that you have in your lives that is worth fighting for. That I know each and every one here, young and old alike, would stand up and say, yes, that is worth fighting for. And I consider myself in on that. My faith is worth fighting for. My family is worth fighting for. My country is definitely worth fighting for. And I hope each and every one of you takes a look at that, because eventually you're going to have to fight. And it's going to be fight or flight. And it's either going to be, you know what, I'm going to stand here and I'm going to put my toe on the line and I'm going to fight. And you have to decide what you're fighting for. Underneath all that, are you fighting so that your family has a roof over their head? Are you going to fight for every paycheck that you get? Are you going to fight so that your kids don't go hungry? What are you going to fight for? Are you going to fight for a flag? Are you going to fight for your country? Some of you will. And I commend that and I applaud that. What are you going to fight for? What do I fight for? I fight for my wife and kids. I fight for my kids especially. I serve in this day and age, in this time of war, our nation is at war. I serve in this time so that my kids, when they grow up, don't have to. That's why I will continue. I hope, and my wife doesn't like it, but I hope that I get a chance to go overseas and fight this war that we're fighting. So that my kids, when they get old enough to enlist, and if they do, I will, it will be a blessing. So that they don't have to. So that the enemies of our country know that America's not going anywhere. Know that we're not going to be attacked anymore. That we're not weak. But you know what? The enemies of our country, they watch CNN. They watch Fox News. They see all the stuff going on in our schools and in our communities. And our enemies, they really think, you know, America's kind of getting weak. You know, they're losing something. They used to be powerful. They used to stand up for what they believed in. But now we have rallies, and we have people picketing, and we have people, you know, standing up in Washington, D.C., and they're saying, you know, this everything that the government stands for, everything the armed services stand for is wrong. You know what? Our enemies are wrong. Because I know, having been in this high school just long enough to see a little tidbit of pride, the little bit of pride is there. And all it's going to take is for your generation and the generation behind you to stand up and say that we're not weak. We stand for what we believe in. We fight for our family, our faith, and our country. That's what it's going to take. Now, just like I said, I'm going to get off all the way off of what I was hoping to talk about. But I'll get back around to it. I'll chase the rabbit back around. You know, my dad's a Southern Baptist preacher, so you guys are in for it. I learned a long time ago how to stand with a microphone in my face. I'm going to tell you a story about And I know I promise I'm not going to take too much of your time, but I'm going to tell you a story about a young man I served with. His name was William Ryan Pritchett. Ryan Pritchett entered service about almost a week after me. And he got to the old guard of D.C. He got there a week before me. So we served from November of 2002 until I got out of service in June of 2006. Now Ryan Pritchett, he moved on. He went down to Germany, got stationed in Germany, and then from there was deployed to Afghanistan. Ryan Pritchett was really young anyway, since I went into the service out of college. He went right out of high school. Out of Martinsville, Indiana. He was an all-American kid. I mean, blonde hair, blue eyes, good-looking kid. Played, you know, basketball in Indiana, which is basically like, you know, playing football in Texas. Or, you know, I mean, he was it at his high school. This past summer, Ryan Pritchett was standing alongside some NATO troops and his own troops, and they were fighting in Afghanistan. He was killed. One of my best friends. I mean, we went up through the ranks together. And you know, when I stood at his funeral and they asked me to speak at his funeral up in Martinsville, and I heard all the great things being said about him, and the whole town turned out. I mean, it was amazing. And you know, I wasn't sad. I wasn't sad that Ryan had died. I was honored because he gave his life for you. He gave his life for freedom, for what he believed in. He gave his life for me. My only wish, as I was thinking about what I was going to say at his funeral, was why couldn't I have taken his place? He had just gotten married 8 months before. His young wife sat at his funeral and just sobbed her eyes out. Not knowing why. You know why? For freedom. It is important. It is so important. Because without freedom, what does America have? Nothing. People knock down our doors. And they come by the boatloads to get into this wonderful country. Because of what we have. And you know what all they care about, really? One thing. Freedom. And you guys, maybe you don't understand. I know these honor veterans here do understand that. But freedom to sit in a class and sleep while the geometry teacher is talking. Freedom to walk through the halls after lunch and throw your trash on the ground. You know, freedom to go out and tear out the parking lot in your car and, you know, almost sideswipe another car. You have freedoms in this country that are not afforded in any other country. And they are worth fighting for. We're going to do one last thing, then I'll be done. It's just going to be a little exercise. Okay, so stretch your legs out. You might have to stand, okay? But what I want you to do is if you have known someone, either a family member or a friend that has served or is serving in Operation Iraqi Freedom or Operation Enduring Freedom, which is Afghanistan. If you know someone, please stand and remain standing. Yeah, awesome. Now don't stand. Don't stand if they're saying, well, you know, this guy does it, but I'll get to you. If you know someone who has either served or who did serve, family or friend, who served in Vietnam, World War II, Grenada, Panama, or any other peacetime service, if you know anybody, uncle, cousin, anybody that you are related to, family or friend, that has served in the United States Armed Forces, please stand. Not too many people sitting. You can look around and you can see that our lives have been touched by veterans. Every person, almost every person, I'd say 90% and probably 100%, but those other kids are exercising their freedom to remain sitting. 100% of the people in this room have been touched by a veteran. You owe your freedoms to veterans, to this flag. So I beg you, respect, and have pride in what we are. We're Americans. Thank you.
I want to introduce a special guest, Command Sergeant Major Herschel Turner. He is Command Sergeant Major of the United States Army Cadet Command at Fort Monroe, Virginia.
I asked the cadet, was that it? Because usually they say a little bit more than what he did. But thank you anyway. And to our distinguished guests here, thanks for being here today. And Colonel, thanks for being here, Principal of the school, and all distinguished guests, just thanks for being here today. And I'm honored to be here. I'm from Fort Monroe, Virginia. I'm the United States Army Cadet Command Sergeant Major for the United States Army. And my boss is Major General Winfield. And everywhere I go, I have to ask the question. Because today is just a great day for me to be here honoring the veterans that have paved the way for us, for this country, through their hard work and dedication. But I got, you know, I gotta be honest with you, I'm so proud to be standing here in uniform. That is the ultimate sacrifice that I can do for my country. So I gotta ask each and every one of you today, if you're just proud to be an American and you feel good about who you are, just clap your hands. To all the veterans that's sitting up in the front, I just gotta tell you, thanks for everything that you have done. Thanks for what you've done in the past. Thanks for what you've done to build this country, to make it the great nation that it is today. Because if it was not for you, this country would not be the way it is today. And I mean that from the heart. Thank you for what you did. Thank you for the time that you spent away from your family. Thank you for the time that you spent away from your mother and your father and your brothers and sisters to serve this country, because it means a lot. And I mean that from the heart. So give all our veterans that sit up in the front a round of applause. Mega whore. When I try to relate what our veterans have done, when I try to relate what our veterans have done and try to relate it to what junior ROTC means, because that's one of the things I do. I go to every high school in the United States and I try to motivate young people to be better citizens. And when I see veterans, I think about the hard work and dedication that they did for this country. I think of one word. I think of good character. The veterans just have good character because they believe in themselves and they believe in this nation. So they always want to do a good job. They always want to give a lot of service back to our country and to our nation and to our cities and to our states. Every place I go to, I visit a veterans home, I visit a nursing home, and I try to talk to people that have done great things. And one thing that I can say about our junior ROTC program is that our young people are becoming better citizens and becoming people with good character because they believe. And they believe in what they've seen from the past of how you all the veterans that have done a great job. And I commend you veterans for doing a great job and being a great example for our junior ROTC cadets. And to our junior ROTC cadets, thank you for putting on a great show today. You have done awesome. Thank you for everything that you have done. And I'd just like to say to the junior ROTC cadets, remember what our veterans done. Remember the character they displayed if they did have to go to war and fight the battles. Remember that they were strong. Remember that they were good servicemen, no matter if it was Army, Air Force, Marine, or Navy. No matter what they did, they had good character, and they believed in themselves, and they were strong. So I want to ask each and every junior ROTC cadet today, make sure that you be a good person of good character, have good values, Believe in yourselves and be strong, just like our veterans were in the past. And I would just like to say to everybody today, thanks for inviting me and thanks for letting me be here today. I admire you. You all are outstanding people. You all are great people. You all are good people in this nation. And I applaud each and every one of you. Thank you for letting me be here today, and God bless you.
I want to thank these singers by name. As I call your name, please stand up. Mr. Allen. And I'm going to mention all the students before you give them a great round of applause. Ms. Harden, please stand up. Ms. B. Mr. Bryson. Ms. Jubilee. Mr. Neal. Give them a great big round of applause. They were fantastic.
You know, I've thought a long time about what I was going to say this year, and I know a lot of you get tired of me talking, but that's all right, too. But I've been trying to think of a definition for a veteran, and there's so many out there that you can just pick them out of the air. But this one caught my eye. I think the American Legion, Fred, the American Legion sent it to me. It says, a veteran, whether active duty, retired, or nation's National Guard or Reserve, is somebody at one point in their life wrote a blank check made out payable to the United States of America for the amount up to and including their lives. What honor, and there are way too many people in this country do not understand that. They wrote a blank check to this country. I think that's the best definition of a veteran that I can found, and I thank these veterans very much. Now, I got a few people I want to say thank you to. First, I've already said that to Mr. Allen. Fairview High School, you cease to amaze me. During class, we can chase you all over the hallways and tell you to go to class, but when you come in here, you just tear me up. You are the best high school in this county. Thank you very much. We had some letters written, which we will later on pass out to one of my commanders. I want him to come up now, but we'll give it to the veterans. We have some special letters from the fifth grade. Fairview Elementary, please stand up. Thank you very much for coming. They basically say, if we didn't have the veterans, I couldn't go to school, I couldn't drive my teacher crazy. Now, there's some others. I want to thank Senator Johnson for coming, our state senator. I thank Ray Smith for being here. I've done another meeting with Sergeant Mitchell. Thank you. Command Sergeant Turner, we salute you. And Mr. Donan, you know, there's been a lot of bad rumors about him out here. But some of them may be true, but I don't know. But I thank him personally for backing this program, and there's a lot of times he has to say no to Major Fultz. That's why Major Fultz goes talk to him. But most of the time it's yes, what we need to do. We thank you and the Cadet Corps. Really appreciate what you do for us, Mr. Donan. Now, I personally want to thank my heroes before I go on. All these young ladies and gentlemen down here. I feel like a youngster in front of them. We thank you for your service. I thank you for coming out. There's 1,500 World War II veterans dying per day now. There's about 16 million left. So think about that. One day, if we don't keep this tradition going, one day we won't have that veteran that fought in a world war and kept this country free. There's only four, what I found out the other day, World War One veterans left in this world. Korean veterans, you're right along with the World War II. Thank you. Vietnam, you went through hell, didn't you? And you're here. Thank you very much. Desert Storm and Iraqi Freedom, we're still in one. We got through with one, now we're in another. I thank you all. Rolling Thunder, I know why the kids came here, to hear those loud machines you drive in. Thank you for showing up, and I appreciate it. We have two special guests, too. Would the two POWs of World War II please stand up? Mr. King and Mr. Southall. They spent time in the room. Thank you. Thank you very much.
part. They fought for about 2 months, and after Christmas and back in Indiana, they liberated from the German onslaught. Only cadets, get your orders. Cadets, stand up. Mr. Hughes, I know our country's proud of this. You received the Bronze Star for this being in the Battle of the Bulge and several other people. And I think it's nice that we present this. Colonel Osborne is going to present this to him officially. And we thank you for your service, sir. I salute you.
But they meet and get to talk. What got me more than anything else
They're like brothers to this day. They haven't seen each other in 60 years. They cry, they talk. This is what these people are all about for the Lord. You ask the veteran, why are you good? You read on the brochure, you'll see what I wrote in the right hand of God, my right hand of God. Why are you good?
Somebody had to do it.
So I did. We thank him a lot. And thank you again. You want to run along and feel free up. For that, Lord, I appreciate what you've done with everybody else.
My page here. As I read this, please remember that 83 Tennessee soldiers have died in the Iraqi war. I can't shake every hand. I can't put flowers on every grave. I can't console every family member, but I can say, thank you. You have given me the freedom I enjoy today. Your blood was shed in place of mine. Your family grieved so mine could rejoice. All I can say is thank you. There are not words big enough. There's not a hug strong enough. There is not a smile wide enough. All I can offer is thank you. You are my hero. You are my thoughts. You are in my prayers. For all you've done, thank you. It's my great honor to introduce to you today a Joint Chief of Staff of the Tennessee National Guard, Colonel Isaac G. Osborne, Jr.
Thank you. Thank you today. I want to thank Fairview High School for having this, to honor veterans, to look out at these World War II veterans, and we are truly in the presence of greatness. Thank you for inviting me here to represent the Tennessee National Guard. And you can be proud of the Guard today. You can be proud of Sergeant Meacham back here. A great speech, and he did a good job, didn't he? Thank you, Sergeant Meacham. Since September the 11th, 2001, there have been 12,000 Tennessee National Guardsmen, over 12,000 mobilized for the global war on terrorism, and most of them spent over a year mobilized. Today we have over 800 in Iraq and Afghanistan. Today there are over 10,800 members of the Tennessee Army National Guard. There are over 3,000 Air National Guardsmen. We have come here today to remember those and to honor those who paid the ultimate sacrifice. Every loss is a loss to our nation, a loss to our military, and more importantly, a loss to the families who grieve. As we gather to honor the memories of the fallen, a piece of us struggles to understand the meaning of such sacrifice and loss. We are not able to return each of the fallen to their families, to erase the pain their loved ones suffered. We can only show our gratitude and hope that the anguish of these families is tempered by the knowledge that their loved ones died for a noble cause. This is what it means to say the dead shall not have died in vain. The following members of the Tennessee Army National Guard have paid the ultimate sacrifice in the global war on terrorism. Sergeant Roger Dale Rowe, hometown Bonacqua. Staff Sergeant David L. Lloyd Jackson. Staff Sergeant Nathan Bailey, Nashville. Sergeant Paul Thomason Talbot, Sergeant First Class Stephen Kennedy, Oak Ridge, Sergeant Alfred Seiler, Duff, Sergeant First Class Mark Edwards, Unicoi, Sergeant James Dustin Carroll, McKenzie, Staff Sergeant Asbury Hahn, Lebanon, Sergeant Shannon Taylor, Smithville, Sergeant Gary Lee Reese, Jr., Ashland City, Sergeant Victor Patrick Lawrence Seymour, Sergeant Joseph D. Hunt, Sweetwater, Sergeant Robert Wesley Tucker, Hillham, Chief Warrant Officer William Timothy Flanagan, Milan, Sergeant Dustin Darrell Laird, Martin, Sergeant Stephen R. Maddies, Elizabethton. Please join me in a moment of silence for these fallen soldiers. Thank you again today for having this program, Fairview High School. Thank you.
This is a poem called Eulogy for a Veteran. Do not stand at my grave and weep. I am not there. I do not sleep. I am a thousand winds that blow. I am the diamond glints on snow. I am the sunlight on ripened grain. I am the gentle autumn rain. When you awaken in the morning hush, I am the swift uplifting rush of quiet birds in circled flight. I am the soft stars that shine at night. Do not stand at my grave and cry. I am not there. I did not die. This poem was not meant to console the grieving families of those who have paid the ultimate sacrifice in the fight for their country. It was meant to show that every veteran that has died in war, their soul lives on in everything they have fought for. Now, if you would please stand with me as the Fairview High School Sound of Gold plays Taps. Thank you.
Here's the challenge. The year 1941. The location, a small town in Nebraska called North Platte. I don't know if you've heard of it. You may have. Some of you may have been there. North Platte was a small town, really, because the nation had just been thrust into World War II. On about the 17th day of December, 1941, 10 days after the bombing of Pearl Harbor, the townspeople got word that a troop train was coming through their town. Well, that was back before the days of air travel. Many soldiers who were going to war traveled on troop trains. Well, they thought it would be fitting if they could do something for the soldiers on this troop train. Much to their joy, they heard they were Nebraska soldiers, and one of the townspeople even thought that her brother would be riding on the train. Townspeople showed up at the train depot about 12 o'clock. train didn't come. About 3 o'clock, the train didn't come. Finally, about 5 o'clock in the evening, the train comes rolling into the station, and there are soldiers on it, and they're waving and yelling, the soldiers' will, their arms hanging out the window, so the townspeople were overjoyed. They had brought cookies, cake, candy, coffee, and all sorts of things to boost the morale of these soldiers. But when the train pulled into the station, they found out they were not Nebraska soldiers. They were Kansas soldiers. A young woman by the name of Ray Wilson, who was not the bank president, she was not the president of the PTO. She was just a clerk in a drugstore. She worked in Walgreens or a place like that in 1941. She said, well, I'm not taking my cookies back home. So, as a result, all the townspeople who had brought stuff gave these items to the Kansas soldiers, and the Kansas soldiers went on their way. The following day, Ms. Wilson wrote this in the paper. Editor, the Daily Bulletin. I don't know just how many people went to meet the trains when the troops went through our city Wednesday, but those who did not should have. To see the spirits and the high morale among those soldiers should certainly put some of us on our feet and make us realize we are really at war. We should keep this soldier morale at its highest peak. We can do our part. During World War I, the Army and Navy mothers, or should I say, the war mothers, had canteens at our own depot. Why can't we, the people of North Platte and the other towns surrounding our community, start a fund and open a canteen now? I would be more than willing to give my time, without charge, to run this canteen. We who met this troop train, which arrived about 5 o'clock, were expecting Nebraska boys. Naturally, we had candy, cigarettes, etc., but we very willingly gave these things to the Kansas boys. Smiles, tears, and laughter followed. Appreciation showed on over 300 faces. An officer told me it was the first time anyone had met the train and that North Platte had helped the boys keep their spirits high. I say, get back of our son and our other mothers 100%. Let's do something and do it in a hurry. We can help this way when we can't help any other way. Ray Wilson founded the canteen, and in the following 54 months, and these numbers are accurate, 54 months, the North Platte canteen had 55,000 volunteers, and they serviced over 6.5 million soldiers on troop trains passing through North Platte. Well, you know, I think we should all have the spirit of Ray Wilson. Whatever you can do, whatever gift God has given you, maybe you need to put that to work, and maybe you need to get behind the veterans, especially the ones in your community, and especially the ones who are suffering, who are wounded, and who need your help. Thank you very much. Following our closing song,
take that away.
Everybody, we'd like to thank you again for coming. High school students, if you will please wait so we can allow our guests and the elementary students to leave at this time. If you'll just wait, I know, and then we'll go on to third period, but if you'll wait a moment, our guests and elementary students are welcome to leave at this time. Thank you again.
I know. Believe me, I know.